Dr. Scholz, can you explain to our audience what Gleason 4+4=8 means?
It's a representation of the aggressiveness and the appearance of the cancer cells under the microscope. And this is useful because the big question with all kinds of cancers, including prostate cancer, is what's the potential for it to spread outside the gland? That's what makes cancer dangerous, the possibility of metastasis. And the old-fashioned scaling Gleason system, which is still in use today, it really has three grades. And to keep it confusing, it starts at 3 being the lowest grade, 4 being a higher grade, and 5 being the highest grade. Sometimes you have more than one grade, and so they have two numbers in case someone has a little bit of one and a little bit of another, so they put a plus sign in between. A 4+4 means that it's pure grade 4, which is would be considered a higher or high grade.
So since it's a high grade cancer, I mean, does the patient need to act with more expediency? Do they still need to do like the secondary biopsy? So I know a lot of patients, when I talk to them, they hear that higher number and they think they need to act immediately. And unfortunately, a lot of people just go straight to surgery. So even though it's a higher grade Gleason score, do they still have time?
They definitely have time. They have plenty of time. When we talk about higher grade versus lower grade, remember we're comparing it to, we're comparing prostate cancer with prostate cancer. If you look at other types of cancers, they're all high grade compared to prostate cancer. In fact, they're higher grade than prostate cancer. But some types of prostate cancer are so low grade, they don't spread, they don't really act like cancers. So the terminology sounds scary, high grade, but really it's just relative to the harmless or the low grade types that prostate cancers that are high grade can spread, but they grow very slowly and they're very treatable.
What does a person do if they need to confirm that they have Gleason 8s?
Well, you're probably referring to the fact that assigning a grade, looking at under the microscope and determining if it's a grade 3, 4, or 5 is a bit of a skill. And that can vary. We've found it's usually helpful to have people get their glass slides from the biopsy and send them off to a reference center. We've been using Johns Hopkins a lot, and to confirm that the number that was assigned is accurate, because the treatment changes. If the number goes up or down, if it goes up, you get higher, stronger treatment. If it goes down, you get milder treatment.
So once a person has confirmed Gleason, 8, and they now we're going into the conversations with their doctor about treatment, what would you like them to keep in mind? So there's a lot of different treatments out there. You know, as a medical oncologist, what do you think is best, and what's really the best protocol to go about choosing a treatment?
Well, in the simplest terms, we're looking at trying to get cured without causing a lot of side effects. And historically, say 10, 15 years ago, surgery was the best option because radiation was not very precise. This, I think, is flip-flopped, and now in 2020, we're looking at radiation probably being the best option to cure the disease and then try and minimize the chance for incontinence and impotence and things like that. The industry is run by surgeons, and so there's still a lot of encouragement to do surgery from the doctors that are managing it, the urologist. But I think for the high-grade cancers, I strongly prefer some form of radiation. If we're talking about a Gleason 4+4, some hormone treatment for 12 to 18 months, seed implant radiation, IMRT. These are the types of things that we're looking at for men with high-grade prostate cancer.
So in choosing the type of radiation that for the treatment, do you have a preference over one or the other, or is it really based on where their cancer is? So what are the factors that would go into that?
Well, traditional prostate cancer treatment doesn't rely on selectively treating the area of the cancer. The whole prostate is targeted. And there are newer thoughts about focal therapy. These are still experimental. They're available and coming quickly. But traditionally, the whole prostate is targeted. And with higher grade disease, studies seem to indicate fairly convincingly that the seed implant radiation, which delivers a higher dose than the beam radiation is capable of, making the seed implant a preferable approach, or at least something to build around. The whole idea of cancer spread, of course, has led to people wanting to use beam radiation to treat the surrounding lymph nodes to cover the possibility that they're spread into the lymph nodes. And that may be changing with the advent of these new PSMA PET scans. Will we be able to skip the beam radiation or even skip the hormone therapy if these scans are clear? This is yet to be determined.
So when you talk about seed implants, I know in other videos we've covered this, but I think it's also very good to know now. Is it really like temporary seeds versus permanent seeds that you've seen a better outcome for Gleason 8?
To the best of my knowledge, the outcomes are equivalent, that it's far more dependent on getting a quality, skilled brachytherapist to do the seed implant. The permanent seeds are more convenient. It's an outpatient procedure. The temporary seeds, you have to go in the hospital. It's more involved. So the permanent seeds tend to be a lot more popular in people that have large cancers that are creeping up into the seminal vesicle. The temporary seeds have a little more flexibility for treating outside the gland. And so with really high-grade disease that's large and advanced, I tend to go with temporary seeds. But the permanent seeds being more convenient are probably, there's 10 to 20 people that have a permanent seed implant for every one that goes through temporary seeds.
So when it comes to, let's say, IMRT and, you know, going and doing, you know, the lower region so you get to different lymph nodes, are there more side effects with that compared to seeds? So why is it that we would choose brachytherapy over IMRT? And are there more benefits if it can go in different directions?
Actually, there are very few additional side effects from treating the lymph nodes. But it's not an either-or thing. Usually with high-grade disease, you're going to at least get a seed implant because that provides the highest cure rates. And then historically and traditionally, they've added IMRT on top of that to the prostate and to the surrounding lymph nodes. That policy is in all likelihood going to continue. So it won't be one or the other, it'll be both.
Thanks for watching. If you would like more information about what we talked about today, you can visit our website at pcri.org. Go ahead and subscribe to our YouTube channel. You will get updates on new videos every single week, and give us a thumbs up if you like this video.